The free thinker from Florida is in.
Carl Jackson is the reason that I was born.
It's the Larry Elder Show with special guest Carl Jackson.
It's not who Carl Jackson is. It just is who we are.
Hey, welcome to the Larry Elder Show. The number to call in is 888-971-7243, 888-971-7243. We're coming to you live from the relieffactor.com studio. Listen, we have a jam-packed show for you today. We are awaiting our guest, hopefully Julie Kelly of American Greatness. In the second hour of the program, we're going to have Michael Knowles of the Daily Wire. He's going to be on the show. He's going to talk to us about his book, Speechless, Controlling Words, Controlling Minds. So we look forward to that, and look forward to that interview with him. And then in the third hour of the program, the one, the only Larry Elder, the great Eldersky, the sage of South Central, Lord willing, the soon-to-be sage of Sacramento, California. We'll have him on the third hour, so stay tuned for that. Again, it's going to be a jam-packed show. And guys, let me just say this. I just got some news before we got on air. Just keep Larry Elder, keep his team in your thoughts and in your prayers. Listen, anytime you're going against the left, they are going to attack you. That means, obviously, you guys have seen the political attacks and the ads and all this kind of stuff that they've been running in the state of California, the columns that have been printed. But there's also been some news of some physical violence that was perpetrated upon some of his security detail. So even directed at Larry Elder himself. So just keep Larry Elder and his team in prayer, seriously. I pray that Larry Elder will have the last laugh come next week. Anyway, let me go straight to the line. Let's go to our guest, Julie Kelly of American Greatness. Julie, welcome back to the Larry Elder Show. We appreciate you coming on.
Hey, Carl, thanks so much for having me on. I'm watching that clip. It's just horrifying what happened.
Isn't it? It's just crazy, Julie. I mean, we live in such a different America today where, we can't agree to disagree anymore. I really believe the left, in my opinion, starting with Obama, maybe it was sooner, but definitely in my opinion, it was with Obama where it just became the left versus the right. You could no longer be friends. Racism all of a sudden seemed to reappear. It's just been absolutely nuts. And the left are just out of their off their rockers, if you ask me. But OK, so, Julie, here's what I want to get to today. If you would give us just a brief synopsis, I got to tell you, I literally left my laptop at home. I don't have it in front of me, so I'm going through notes. I'm going through memory on some of this stuff here. But if you will give us a brief synopsis of the I always forget the name of the gentleman, and I'm sorry, that was wearing the costume, the get up. He recently pled guilty. But after that synopsis, I really want to talk about this story of Roseanne Boylan. Julie, this is in my opinion, this is a bombshell. I was sitting there reading through this article, Julie, and I said, you know what? When Julie was a kid, she must have played like private detective, pretend all the time with her friends. This is true investigative journalism. I think I caught you, didn't I, Julie? You were that girl. You always wanted to be the private investigator because it shows in your work. This is excellent work. I encourage everybody right now to go to amgreatness.com, read this article. What did the Capitol celebrity cops do to Roseanne Boylan? And this has sounded fishy all along to me. And honestly, I just can't wait to get into this. But first, let's get the synopsis on the other column.
Well, I have to fess up, and now I'm going to age myself. But I did play Charlie's Angels all the time with my sister and our neighbor.
It fits. It fits.
There you go. That's how it all started back in the late 70s. But yes, this story, and I really hope people read it, and I hope it gets some attention from some lawmakers who need to start asking more questions, any questions about January 6th. But it does look like there is a possibility that U.S. Capitol Police and possibly D.C. Metro Police contributed to the death of yet another female Trump supporter on January 6th, and that is, she is Roseanne Boyland. We were told by the D.C. Medical Examiner's Office, who is not a trustworthy agency whatsoever, that she died of a drug overdose. But we know that she was near and outside the tunnel, the West Terrace Tunnel, where a lot of the clashes between protesters and police took place that afternoon. We know that police used a highly toxic gas in that tunnel. We don't know what it is, Carl, but I've read in charging documents, well, actually in affidavits filed from investigators and interviews, and seen plenty of video about how toxic this gas was that caused people to stop breathing, caused them to vomit in the tunnel, caused people who had asthma to have asthma attacks. It was very potent stuff. And so it looked like Roseanne Boyland was attacked with this gas. She passed out. Then she was, this mob sort of tumbled on top of her after the police were shoving people out of the tunnel using their riot shields, beating them with batons. And she was outside the tunnel. Body cam footage says about 4:26. Well, Officer Ginnell, who is one of the U.S. Capitol Police officers who testified before the January 6th Commission, and he has given a ton of interviews, he testified to Nancy Pelosi's Select Committee that he administered CPR to her at 4:26. Now, that's kind of weird because at that time she is passed out, almost dead. What her friend said at the time with her that she was dead at that time. But then they dragged her body through this toxic tunnel and into the Capitol building. So we could talk about some of the details there. But that's just setting up what happened to her on that afternoon.
Okay. Now, I'm reading through the quote of this gentleman, Philip Anderson, who was a protester. And he said that cops did, in fact, use excessive force. He says, I do not know what type of gas the officers used, but I know for sure that it wasn't tear gas. Mm-hmm. He says, after the officer sprayed this gas at me, I couldn't breathe for longer than a few seconds. This gas caused me to collapse, where the police then proceeded to push others on top of me. There were many others who collapsed because of these toxins, as I did. The police continued hitting me and others. One of the people that fell in the crowd was a woman by the name of Roseanne Boyland. And of course, that's who we're talking about today. So, Julie, I sit here now wondering if this lady died of a drug overdose at all, but perhaps how could they even do a toxicology report so quickly too? Now that comes to mind. But I really would like to know, what this gas was that they were using, because obviously it was extremely important and potent if it's going to take your breath away for more than a few seconds. So this is pretty amazing to me. But this is these cops, and you've talked about this before, Julie, mm-hmm. but these cops basically seem to be a part of the Democratic cartel, if you will, in D.C. Am I wrong? Am I going too far with that?
No, you're actually being kind. They were the Nancy Pelosi stormtroopers, the U.S. Capitol Police, and D.C. Metro Police. They started attacking the people.
Julie, we got 30 seconds before the break. Can you stay for another segment, or do you need to go?
I sure can, yes.
Okay. Okay, go ahead. You got 20 seconds.
So we'll talk about this. They were attacking peaceful protesters outside the building at 1 o'clock, provoking them into these clashes that we saw. We can talk about that on the other side of the break. But it's very important to underscore that point.
Unbelievable. All right, we're talking to Julie Kelly of American Greatness. This is Carl Jackson in for Larry Elder. We'll be right back.
Larry Elder here again with a message for anyone struggling with pain, like I struggled with for years. And of course, I want you to know about Relief Factor, the 100% drug-free supplement that tens of thousands are now taking every day. Obviously, I'm taking it every day because I like being out of pain. But I know you may be skeptical, just like I was. But then I kept hearing about all the people who are no longer in pain, so I decided to give it a try. In fact, listen to Janice's story.
I was skeptical at first, but because of the pain that I was having when I would substitute teach and have to climb stairs, so I have lower back, hip, and even knee pain. And after about 3 weeks, I found that I could climb stairs pain-free. But it wasn't only pain-free. I could do it step over step without holding on the railing. I'm really happy. It makes me feel like I'm young again.
That's relieffactor.com or call 800-583-84, 800-583-84.
Where's the sage? He's saving California. And now, here's special guest Carl Jackson on The Larry Elder Show.
All right, welcome back to The Larry Elder Show. I'm speaking to my guest, Julie Kelly, of American Greatness. You can find her on Twitter at Julie_Kelly and the number 2. That's at Julie_Kelly and the number 2. I'll be sure and tweet this story out. You guys out there, do the same. Share it on Facebook or, you know, wherever you are on social media, and hopefully not canceled. I'm being shadow banned right now, Julie. I'll get the word out the best I can. That is for sure. I need to go to one of these newer sites. I don't know why I have not as of yet. But anyway, I'll do that. All right. We are speaking to Julie Kelly. The title of the column is What Did the Capitol Celebrity Cops Do to Roseanne Boylan? And just, for those of you that may not know, there was a Trump supporter, that supposedly died of a drug overdose. What we're learning through reading Julie Kelly's material is that this woman was perhaps beaten by cops, and there was a gas of some sort sprayed upon some of the protesters that was extremely strong, and this may have caused Roseanne Boylan to fall and perhaps even die, because there's word that she was, I mean, literally people fell on top of her, all this kind of stuff, with cops pushing her back and all this type of nonsense. Julie, I want to go to some of the testimony of this police officer, Harry Dunn, this Capitol police officer. He says, in the crypt, I encountered Sergeant Gunnell, who was giving assistance to an unconscious woman who had been in the crowd of rioters on the west side of the Capitol. And then he said, I helped to carry her to the House Majority Leader's office, where she was administered CPR. Now, you've already touched on this, but I want to go into greater detail here. Gunnell testified that around this occurred basically around 4:26 p.m. on 1/6, where he gave her CPR to one of the rioters who breached the Capitol in an effort to save her life. But that doesn't necessarily jive, does it, Julie?
It does not jive. And let's think about this for a minute, because the man who was her friend, who went with her, Justin Winchell, was yelling, and you could see it in the video, yeah. She's dead, I need help. And this is when she was outside of the tunnel. So you have Gunnell, and who knows what other officer, drag her through this tunnel. Harry Dunn, at some point, picks her up. Why would they not administer emergency medical help right then and there outside the tunnel? Well, they obviously are trying to drag her body into the building where she's concealed from the public or people taking videos. Harry Dunn testifies he takes her into Steny Hoyer's office, the House Majority Leader, which is so bizarre. Why would they be handling a woman who's either suffering from a medical emergency, almost dying or dead at that point? And then the paramedics arrive, take her to the hospital. She's pronounced dead at 6:09. I mean, none of this makes any sense, except that they were trying to hide yet the body, just like they dragged Ashley Babbitt down the stairs and nobody could see her. And we're going to learn more details about how they mishandled her body after she was shot and killed. Wow. And here we have another woman who these men, these Capitol Police, spray her, contribute to her death, if not kill her, then drag her body through the tunnel, put her in Steny Hoyer's office to hide her, body until the paramedics show up and take her out.
There's
and
a
this is based on their testimony. I want to make sure this is
right.
Their testimony. This is what they told the January 6th commission. Everyone ignored it, but then I picked up on it after this new affidavit by Philip, who is talking about the abusive tactics of the police officers on the scene.
You know what's striking to me as well, Julie. So so these police officers in this what's the name of in the West Terrace Tunnel seem mm-hmm. to be equipped and or trained well enough to, I mean, physically hurt protesters, spray some type of irritant on protesters that was extremely, just horrible. It sounds from this, but yet there was this major Capitol breach where people just went buck. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't add up to me. I'm not a conspiracy theorist at all, but I mean, the world has just gone crazy in the last couple of years, and none of this seems to add up to me. Your take?
Well, they're hiding 14,000 hours of surveillance video. The U.S. Capitol Police
that's
and
right.
Justice Department have 14,000 hours of video taken that day. Not only do they not want to make it public to available to the public, they are trying to even keep it from defendants and defense attorneys. And whatever little clips they turn over the Justice Department, they want under protective orders. There are very tight rules, even how defendants can look at video clips that are supposed to show them committing a crime. And so they're not subjected to FOIA, unfortunately. They're part of the legislative branch, which was genius. So nobody can FOIA and access this video that has been under tight control. They have classified it as highly sensitive government material. So it's basically classified information that nobody can get a hold of unless U.S. Capitol Police and Joe Biden's Justice Department sign off on it, which they're not. So all of this should raise a lot of questions in the minds of people who originally bought into the narrative of what happened January 6th instead of what it increasingly looks like an inside job concocted by the Democrats and executed partially by U.S. Capitol Police and D.C. Metro Police.
This is nothing short of stunning to me. The only way that I suppose we could get the video, the 14,000 hours of video, is determinative of on Republicans winning the Congress back. Is that correct?
I mean, yes. I wish I believed that even if they won the House and Senate back, that they would do anything. Because
I know, that's
you know,
so sad. You're right.
They have been so silent on the abuse, this abusive investigation, concealing evidence, withholding the name of the officer who shot and killed Ashley Babbitt for months. And then when he was finally identified, basically helping the Democrats and media praise him as a hero for what he did. You have Kevin McCarthy just sent the Capitol Police Chick-fil-A the other day for what? Thanking them for shooting and killing an unarmed veteran in the United States Capitol building. I mean, these people have no one to defend them. And so, unfortunately, I don't think it matters if Republicans take over. They're gonna go right along with keeping this under wraps, just like the Democrats are.
Do you suppose, it seems to me that Republicans, we only have 30 seconds left here, Julie. Seems to me that Republicans, at least these established Republicans, seem to hate Trump as much as Democrats do, and perhaps this is the reason why they're not speaking out, or they're just cowards in general?
They're cowards in general. They're afraid. And not only, hating Trump is one thing, but abandoning your own base and letting the fact that political prisoners now languish in a jail in Washington, D.C., and no one can speak up for them except for a handful of Republican lawmakers. This is not a party that deserves to get power back. So, unfortunately,
Julie Kelly. Julie Kelly of AM Greatness, thank you.
Carl, thank you so much.
This year, to mark 20 years since 9/11, the Tunnel to Towers Foundation is giving 200 mortgage-free homes to Gold Star and fallen first responder families with young children. and catastrophically injured veterans and first responders. The foundation's chairman and CEO walked for the month of August through to September 11th from the Pentagon to Shanksville, Pennsylvania, and on to Ground Zero. The foundation brought back Towers of Light to the memorials at the Pentagon and in Shanksville, read the names aloud of all we lost to 9/11 related illness, and on Veterans Day, and a first for our country, the foundation is having a ceremony to read aloud the names of service members we lost in the war on terror. Help this nation to never forget its greatest heroes. Do good in their honor. Donate $11 a month to Tunnel to Towers at T2T.org. That's T, the number 2T.org.
Everybody's talking at me. I don't hear a word they're saying. Only the echoes of my mind.
Free speech lives here on The Larry Elder Show with special guest Carl Jackson.
All right, welcome back to The Larry Elder Show. The number to call in, 888-971-7243. 888-971-7243. We're coming to you live from the ReliefFactor.com studio. Listen, guys, I encourage you every week to check out Julie Kelly's articles because, you know, as I say, this isn't just about the 1-6 protesters. This is about you and I. The Biden administration, the left would do this to us just like they would our fellow Americans. They don't care about people. They leave people in jail. Without their due rights. I mean, these people are serving, many of them being charged with a misdemeanor, some upgraded to felonies, but many with a misdemeanor. And they're serving their full sentence oftentimes before they even get before a judge. This is unprecedented. These are political prisoners. And so we see this happening. We see this happening with the January 6th protesters. We know that the Biden administration has left people behind, Americans behind, on foreign soil in Afghanistan. They've left some credible SIVs, special immigrant visas, behind. This is who they are. And this would happen to every single one of us. So I encourage you to not only read her columns, but to share her columns. Because in my opinion, they are that important. I think it's one of the most important issues out there, because if we don't have the rule of law, we don't have America. It's as simple as that. America is great. America is exceptional because of our rule of law, because of our Judeo-Christian value system. But we have this rule of law. We have this thing called the Constitution that all of these people are to abide by, whether it's the executive branch, the judicial branch, the legislative branch. And if there's no checks and balances, then things just run amok. So just keep that in mind. All right, let me talk to you about this. Let me talk to you about this. Four Taliban members are swapped for Bo Bergdahl, now in the Afghan government. Hat tip, Sean. Here's what I want you to understand. This is, I don't know. How do I say this? I don't know that this much incompetence and naivete exists in the world. Again, you guys know me. I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but it is hard to believe that this stuff isn't happening intentionally. So here's what Obama did. Let me frame this for you, okay? So Obama gave the Taliban, I want you to think about this. Obama gave the Taliban their new generals, but Biden gave them their weaponry and their new embassy, not to mention Bagram Air Force Base. Something's amiss here, guys. Something's amiss here. Something isn't right. Something isn't adding up. This from the New York Post. Four of the five Taliban members released from Guantanamo Bay by Obama in 2014 in exchange for admitted U.S. Army deserter, I'll say traitor, Bo Bergdahl, are part of the Islamic fundamentalist group's new hardline government in Afghanistan. This according to local media reports. Here are the roles of the so-called Taliban Five that are in the new government. All right, so the four members of the so-called Taliban Five are: one, there's an acting director of intelligence. His name is Abdul Haq Wasik. And when you say Hach, you got to say it like that. Otherwise, it just doesn't feel, you know. So Abdul Hach Wasik. And then there's Acting Minister of Borders and Tribal Affairs, Nurullah Noori. There's Deputy Defense Minister, Muhammad Fazil. And then there's Acting Minister of Information and Culture. That strikes me as very funny. The Acting Minister of Information and Culture, Karula Karkai, not to be mistaken for Jarul or a Kardashian. The fifth member of the Taliban Five, Muhammad Nabi Omari, was appointed governor of the Eastern Coast Province last month. So the new caretaker government is made up of a list of faces that are similar, or I'm sorry, that are familiar to the U.S. So these people who helped run the war-torn country between 1996 and 2001, when the Taliban were forced from power by the U.S.-led NATO forces following 9/11, these guys are back. Familiar faces. It's almost as if these people are trying to taunt us. It's almost as if these people are trying to tell us that we didn't break them, that they're still intact. It's almost as if these people are laughing at us because they know we have the weakest president ever.
Everybody's talking at me. Can't hear a word they're saying.
And now, Carl Jackson for The Sage on The Larry Elder Show.
All right, welcome back to The Larry Elder Show. The number to call in to the ReliefFactor.com studio is 888-971-7243. 888-971-7243. Let me talk to you about Cry Macho. Warner Brothers Pictures presents Cry Macho. From legendary director Clint Eastwood comes a story of being lost and found. Eastwood returns as a one-time rodeo star and washed-up horse breeder. He takes a job to bring back a man's young son home from Mexico. The unlikely pair face an unexpectedly challenging journey. The only road home is through redemption. See it in theaters and on HBO Max for 31 days. Starting September 17th, rated PG-13. Check it out. You guys know you love Clint Eastwood. Clint Eastwood is the bomb. I love that guy. I can't wait to check it out myself, honestly. All right, getting back to this story. Four Taliban members swapped for Bo Bergdahl now are in the Afghan government. And again, I'll say Obama gave the Taliban their new generals, but you have Biden, who's in office, this weak, feckless president that's in office that has given them the weaponry and the embassy that they needed. And now you have a Biden administration that is just seriously itching to give the Taliban money. It's absolutely astonishing to me. It's as if Obama, Biden, Harris are spitting in the face. Actually, it's not as if. That is exactly what they're doing. That is exactly what they're doing. 20 years, blood, sweat, tears, lost limbs. Obama releases these guys back in 2014, swap them for Bo Bergdahl, someone that deserted his squad. Other gentlemen that went to search for this guy were injured. And now these guys are in the head of the Afghan government. And they're powerful. They're more powerful than ever. I mean, they've got weapons galore. They've got Humvees. They've got night goggles. They took out these other provinces in no time. Thanks in part to our military equipment. I wouldn't doubt if China and Russia helped along the way as well. Some of the positions that these guys held in the old government, Wasik, Fazal, and Karakai, all held positions in the former Taliban government. Wasik as a deputy intelligence chief, Faisal as army chief of staff, and Karakai as interior minister. I want to know where these guys were. Maybe it's just that I'm uninformed. I'm uninformed. I haven't read up on it. But I'd like to know where these guys were this entire time. Why is it that these guys never got a bullet between their eyes? This is what I'd like to know. Acquiring minds would like to know. According to assessments written in 08 by the leadership at Guantanamo Bay, and this was later made public to WikiLeaks, Wasik utilized his office to support al-Qaeda and to assist Taliban personnel elude capture. And he was central to the Taliban's efforts to form alliances with other Islamic fundamentalist groups to fight alongside the Taliban against U.S. and coalition forces. So these people were our enemies. This guy recruited other Islamic fundamentalist groups to kill and to maim our soldiers. Joe Biden and his administration, Blinken, Secretary of Defense Austin Lloyd, General Milley, I guess all are of the belief that somehow, some way, these people are going to be able to behave and somehow operate a functioning government of some sort. Leftism is destroying America. It's destroying our foreign policy. It's destroying our credibility. This makes no sense to me whatsoever. The same assessment said that Fazel was alleged to have, and I quote, operational associations with significant al-Qaeda and other extremist personnel. These are the people that the Biden administration now want to give money to. And these people, they want to rush past this story. And I get it. If I were in office, if I were in this administration, if I were as disastrous as Joe Biden has been thus far, I'd want to move past this story. We cannot allow him to move past this story. We can't allow, honestly, Republicans to move past this story. You know, it's a sad state of affairs, but, you know, speaking to Julie Kelly of American Greatness earlier, she hit the nail on the head. I mean, the truth of the matter is, are any of you confident that the current crop of Republicans in Washington, D.C., except for a handful, obviously, in the Senate and in the House, will do anything about 1-6, about January 6th, about retrieving and making sure that that video is made public? I'm not. See, this is why it's important that right now, we're in the primary season, it's important that we pick the right candidates so that ultimately we don't get bad policies like we're seeing here. Fazel and Nouri were governor of two northern Afghan provinces during the early Taliban regime, and they're accused of ordering the massacres of ethnic Hazara, Tajik, and Uzbek communities in the city of Mazar Sharif. This was back in 1998. Then you have Karakai. I don't know how to pronounce the name. These names, and honestly, I don't care. I'm frustrated that these people aren't dead, to be honest with you. Karakai, who helped found the Taliban in 94, allegedly took part in, I quote, meetings with Iranian officials seeking to support hostilities against U.S. and coalition forces. Okay, let me repeat that. Karakai, who helped found the Taliban in 1994, took part in meetings with Iranian officials seeking to support hostilities against U.S. and coalition forces. Folks, these are the people that Biden has said it's worth working with. These are the people Biden has said it's worth leaving Americans behind in Afghanistan in order to have a relationship with these people that have killed Americans. This is who we have in the White House. This guy needs to go. Why every Republican is not screaming impeach or resign, I do not know. We'll be back.
now, here's special guest Carl Jackson on The Larry Elder Show.
All right, guys, welcome back to The Larry Elder Show. We're talking about how Biden, actually Obama, gave the Taliban, the existing Taliban, their generals, and the Obama gave the Taliban their new existing generals and their new government, and Biden gave them their weaponry, their embassy and Air Force Base. It's almost as if this is what they wanted to do. It's almost as if the Obama and Biden and now Harris legacy may be to restore the Middle East. This is very disturbing what we're seeing. But here's some good news, and we'll get into this a little later in the show as well. This just breaking from Breitbart: Joe Biden's approval rating collapses to 39%. Thank the Lord. The lowest of his presidency. So Joe Biden's approval rating has collapsed to 39%. This is the lowest of his presidency. This, according to a Wednesday Economist YouGov poll, while only 39% approve of Biden's job performance, 49% now disapprove. This is a drop of 6 points in just 1 week. Overall, Biden's evaporating approval numbers are primarily due to Democrats who have begun abandoning him amid the challenges of inflation, Afghanistan, the Wuhan virus. Nearly 9 out of 10 Democrats had approved of Biden for almost half of this first year, but Democrats have since dropped support of the president by 9% in 1 week. This is fascinating. This is what he deserves. Why Republicans are not kicking this man while he's down. We got to play their game, guys. I'm sorry. The country is at stake. We can't be these little soft, sweet. Hey, we'll get them in 2022. We may not have until 2022. This is insanity. This guy has just militarized a terrorist organization. This guy is destroying our economy. Speak up, Republicans, for God's sake. Let's go to John in California. John, you got the mic. You got a minute.
Hi, Carl. Real quick, before I get into Afghanistan, I just want to say to tell everybody to vote in person out here in California. If you don't want your vote thrown away or changed, please vote in person. But my thing is that I really feel that there's somebody else calling the shots. Joe Biden, obviously, he's not all there, and there's somebody else pulling the strings behind all this, and how these people are in Guantanamo, and they just happen to be, in charge of the Taliban right now, and they were gifted with all these weapons. I mean, we just got to wake up and smell the coffee because
John, for the sake of time, I get the point. I appreciate the call. Listen, there's no doubt the blame has to go to Biden. He's the figurehead. I realize there are other people doing stuff behind the scenes. Ultimately, he's the president. The Republicans need to attack there.
Portions of today's Larry Elder Show are brought to you in part by Warner Brothers Pictures, Cry Macho.